Hello, it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you for the public lecture Shouldering a Legacy, the Case of Dhurandhars and Trindads by Dr. Manisha Patil. Dr. Manisha Patil completed her painting graduation from Nagpur University and post-graduation and PhD in Art History from MS University, Baroda. She has taught at Chitrakala Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur and is at present teaching faculty of art history at Sir Jeju School of Art, Mumbai. She is a practicing artist and has displayed her paintings at several exhibitions across the country. She has also contributed to several art publications like Art News and Art Journal. At NGMA, she recently curated an exhibition, Rethinking the Regional, that reflects different trends in various regions of Maharashtra from early independence. I request Dr. Manisha Patil to share her views regarding the subject.
Thank you, Snehal. It's my pleasure to be here amongst you in this small but intimate auditorium space. And I'm going to talk about Dhurandhar, M.V. Dhurandhar, his daughter, and Antonio Xavier Trindad and his daughter, Angela, in this small presentation which I'm going to make here. The reason why I took up this subject was that there were several reasons. First, that I was doing a module for the Bhavdaji Lal Museum on Bombay School, and this lecture is an extension of what I've been talking about in this module for the last 2 days. Secondly, I thought that there were several questions which are often asked as to, as regarding the JJ School of Art, as to why were there not many girls enrolled at the school. And well, there were a few students who were quite good at their work, and the ones who are featured in the presentation today were amongst them. The girls came, did not enroll very frequently, but they were a part of the student fraternity of the School of Art. So what I'm going to present is here, Dhurandhar and Ambika as a pair, father and daughter, Antonio Xavier Trindad and his daughter Angela as a pair, and share their various kinds of their work, their relationship with each other, and the kind of legacy which the daughters inherited from their illustrious father. So largely I'm going to read out what my presentation and accompany it with the PowerPoint here. Dhurandhar and Trindad were both prolific painters, and it so happens that they both were in the JJ School of Art around the same time. This is around the late 19th century. Both of them have left for us a vast body of works, fortunately. Though now they are dispersed in various collections, we do get an idea as to the kind of work they did, the kind of convictions they had, the subject matter which they handled, and so on and so forth. And we also have some works of Ambika Dhurandhar, Dhurandhar's daughter, and Angela Trindad with us. So I'm going to share this work with you. First, an introduction to the two stalwarts, Dhurandhar and Trindad, in their self-portraits, selfies here. They studied in JJ School of Art, as I said, approximately at the same time. So before we go to JJ School of Art, the art school, I'm going to introduce you to their intimate homes. So we have the home of Trindad, Casabianca. The home of the Goan artist Antonio Xavier Trindad in Mahim, called Casabianca, was a warm and lively place, reverberating with a vigor and infectious energy. There was a constant give and take of ideas and interactions between the members of the artist's large family of 8 children, 3 sons and 5 daughters, admiringly managed by Trindad's wife, Florentina. One of the children followed Trindad's footsteps. She was Angela, the fourth born. Angela, like her illustrious father, trained at Sir JJ School of Art and devoted her life to painting and teaching. Not far from the Trindads, in the suburb of Khar, was Ambasadan, the residence of a major figure in the narrative of pre-independence Indian art, Mahadev Vishwanath Dhurandhar. As I said, they were contemporaries in the school of art. Dhurandhar's second born, Ambika, shared his passion for art and studied at JJ School of Art too. Her life thereafter revolved around art, largely in the company of her watchful and proud father. He was extremely proud of his daughter's achievements. It was Ambika who was to be the caretaker of Dhurandhar's vast collection of works bequeathed to her at his death in 1944. Sorry, we just seem to be going a little fast. This paper takes us to the workplaces of these two eminent artists who essayed stellar roles in the Bombay art scene in general and JJ School of Art in particular. They saw pedagogical shifts within the art school in the closing years of the 19th and the early years of the 20th century. It further covers the careers of the next generation of artists and their families, their daughters, who in some measure were inheritors of their talent and also strived to preserve their father's memories for posterity. It dwells on the father-daughter bonding of two artists who shared education, profession, and a passion for art. We turn the clock back to the formative years of the Bombay School with its pivot at Jamshedji Jiji Boys School of Art. Established in 1857 with a generous endowment of 1 lakh rupees by Sir Jamshedji Jiji Boy, the art school had by the closing years of the 19th century produced some extremely talented young painters under the tutelage of John Griffiths, the British instructor who had been asked to come to Bombay to teach art, along with Lockwood Kipling. So Griffiths headed the painting department while his close friend Lockwood Kipling, father of Rudyard, the famous writer, headed the sculpture department. Pestanji Bumanji, M.F. Pithawala, Abalal Rahman, M.V. Dhurandhar, A.X. Trindad and S.L. Hardankar, all of them were among the earliest batch of gifted artists passing out from the art school. Many first path-breaking ventures, that is, had taken place, and the copying of Ajanta murals under the headship of John Griffiths was one of them. The work went on for 12 long years and a large number of copies were produced at that time. That was also followed by some other art schools taking up the project, and then but Bomanji was a member of the team which did that. Now Mahadev Vishwanath Dhurandhar was a self-made man. I'm going to talk about his work first. Hailing from a modest Pathare Prabhu middle-class background of Kolhapur, he was quick to attune himself to the hallowed spaces of JJ, which he entered for the first time as a young man. The year was 1890. In his memoirs, a visibly impressed Dhurandhar recalls his first glimpse of the Greek and Roman statuary in the JJ school, which filled him with excitement and awe. Dhurandhar's memoirs, Kala Mandirate Likhe Chais Varshe, has numerous references to the working of JJ School of Art, where he studied till 1896. So the work which we are seeing here is the academic work which Dhurandhar did. And as you will notice in many of the labels, many of these works are from the collection of JJ School of Art. He was obviously a great admirer of his teacher John Griffiths, and amongst his early recollections is a student excursion to Ahmedabad. As the young Dhurandhar struggled to grapple with the drawing of the Roopmati Mosque, which is to the left of the which is the image to the left, Griffiths explained the rudiments of perspective, making some swift drawings on paper. Dhurandhar was very quick to grasp this and completed his watercolor landscape with remarkable flair. And just as a comparison, I've got this photograph. It's an old photograph of the Rani Roopmati Mosque. And I'm sure you can see that Dhurandhar has done quite a commendable job here. They were taught all kinds of things in JJ, and one of the many things which they were taught was decorative design. So this is one example of what Dhurandhar did in the academic during his academic training. It was done for the wall decoration. Dhurandhar in his memoirs also lists his teachers such as Ganpat Rao Kedari and class fellows, which include Trindad, Taskar and Agaskar. He also mentions in passing how many talented students succumbed to the plague that hit Bombay in the late 1890s. Apart from Griffiths, the vice principal, Greenwood, was also kind to Dharandhar. He once sent his works to the Bombay Art Society, where it won a prize of 50 rupees, which was a big sum those days, and also procured him a job in a school, which was before he joined JJ as a teacher. Dharandhar shot into eminence in 1895 when his oil painting won the gold medal at the Bombay Art Society. It was a typical Maharashtrian interpretation of a festival, Gauri festival, and it was titled, Do You Come, Lakshmi? It was about welcoming, as you can see, the image of Gauri at the threshold of the eve of the puja. Being recognized at the Bombay Art Society was a very big thing those days, a signal of having arrived. Incidentally, Dharandhar was the first Indian to win a medal at the Bombay Art Society. In the light of the scarcity of documentation of the working of the JJ School of Art in its early years, Dharandhar's memoirs, supplemented with photographs, though self-congratulatory, remains a useful source. It traces major events of the colonial rule, including the visit of the Prince of Wales in 1921, for which special pylons were designed by Dharandhar. The controversial pylons were commissioned to JJ in the tenure of Solomon, and after negotiating with architect George Whitted for a decent budget, which was raised from 8,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees, several students like Savardekar, Sardesai, Panwalkar, and also teachers such as Agaskar, Sudekar, Mistri, Taskar, etc. were assigned on the collaborative work. But Dharandhar also received a lot of brickbats for, you know, what happened was that the many agitators of the non-cooperation movement rebelled against him, and he had to also seek police protection. The autobiography tells us about the artist's successful ascent to the top rung of the career and the tenures of several British heads, John Griffiths, Greenwood, Cecil Burns, and Gladstone Solomon. Associated with JJ School of Art for close to 41 years, Dharandhar carved his own space, initially as a student, then teacher, then principal, and finally the director of the art school. Acknowledging his contribution to art and society, the government conferred him with the title Rao Bahadur, and thenceforward he was known as Rao Bahadur Dharandhar. Dharandhar records numerous happenings in JJ School of Art and the tenure of different principals, regular excursions of the art school to different places, the threats of closure of the art school, which hit JJ intermittently. Initially in his early days, there was this whole business of shifting the art school to Matunga. They wanted to shift it from the present location to Matunga. Then there was another obstacle which happened during the Thomas Committee, which wanted the school to close down altogether. So Dharandhar has made detailed records of this, and I'm going to talk about this painting when I talk about Ambika Dharandhar, because she is the one who reveals information about this painting. This was also exhibited at the Bombay Art Society, but earlier, even before he exhibited his famous gold medal winning painting, Do You Come Lakshmi. So this had also won an award, and maybe I can just, now that I'm showing it, I can also tell you this story. Dharandhar does not mention this incident at all in his writings, but it comes through in the writings of his daughter, when she writes her memoirs, and she remembers her father telling him about this particular work, which was actually the model of this particular painting, the one, the singer with the Tanpura here, was a famous singer of that time, Anjani Bai Malpekar, who later taught a lot of musicians. And she used to stay in Ghendi Bazaar, that area, and then he happened to be present there one of those days, and he actually made a sketch of the people performing, and then he came back and did the painting. So we will come to the oleograph later. Figure painting remained a long passion for Dharandhar, and he continued to produce nudes and draped figures throughout his career. He often relied on prints and photographs to study the nude, a common practice by salon artists of his times. Again, his compositions dealt mostly with women from different social milieu, as you can see here. But time and again, he came back to his own community, the Pathare Prabhus. They were extremely artistically inclined and fashionable also. They were also highly educated, and they had certain kind of sartorial tastes, and many of the times he features social events like this. Some very often even the Brahmins were included in his works. A prolific artist. These are the kind of works which Dhurandhar did. Dhurandhar has done some large-scale works, but I feel that he was more comfortable with the small-format works. He has done a lot of oils, but he was more comfortable with the watercolor medium, which he could handle with ease, and which was also very suitable for the kind of work he was doing, not only for himself, but also for public consumption. So we are going to look at some of these works. He did a lot of illustrations, and Dhurandhar was probably one of the most popular illustrators of his times. And he kind of managed both his career as a teacher and his job as an illustrator and artist. So we'll come back to one of these incidents later when they did the murals for the Delhi Secretariat. But I just wanted to point out that Dhurandhar was extremely close to the principal of the art school, Gladstone Solomon, who was in charge of JJ School of Art from 1919 to 1936. And they often worked together. In fact, there were a lot of senior teachers, but Dhurandhar held a special place, not only because he was extremely cooperative, he kind of bent down and adjusted to whatever Solomon's demands were, and he was also talented. So all together, he was a close aide of Solomon. I was talking about this particular mural commission, which was an important phase of the development of the JJ School of Art. Around this time, we are in the 1920s now, when Lutyens was building up Delhi, the capital of Delhi, and the secretariat was being designed, and they wanted it to be decorated with different kinds of murals. And there was a problem here, because Bombay School was not really known for its involvement with the mural medium. It was Bengal all the time. And Solomon, the shrewd person that he was, the visionary that he was, he started what was known as the Indian class in the art school. And he also started a class of nude, teaching nude, so that he could, deploy these kind of activities in the curriculum to take it further and get some share of the mural commission, which he finally did. And there was a lot of they were rushing from Delhi to Bombay, from Bombay to Delhi, and trying to get everything patched up together. And it was always Dhurandhar who was in the forefront, because he was senior and he was also extremely active. So Dhurandhar first, he mentions this in his memoirs. He went to Delhi, he got the sketches, he measured the space, he saw the plan and elevation of the secretariat, came back, did the sketches, he took the help of his daughter as well, and then he kind of in record time, he was not really very young then, but he was almost on the verge of retirement, he managed to garner all his energy, and he finally, these are the kind of works which he has done. He's done four paintings for the Delhi Secretariat, and this is not tempera. This is not tempera or fresco. These were done by a technique which was developed by the Bombay School called marouflage, which is a technique wherein you paint on canvas, oil on canvas, and then you transfer the canvases, which are actually measured in whatever size and dimensions which are required at site, and then they used to paste it there. So this is the technique which Dhurandhar has used here.
What is the technique you said again?
Marouflage, M-A-R-O-U-F-L-A-G-E.
Thank you.
Can you just drop down the temperature a bit? It's very warm here. So we go on further to Dhurandhar's career as an illustrator. It so happened that the early 1900s, there was a lot of development in technology for visual communication. Yes? Is it done? Cool, thanda karo, aur thanda karo. It's a warm day. Yeah, aata barobar hai. Thank you. So we are in the 1900s, and this was the time when the print industry was coming into the fore. There was also scope to do advertising, and we are going to see a few works of, what Dhurandhar did at that time. And he was also sought after as an illustrator for various kinds of publications which were done then. This is one called Women of India, written by Otto Rothfield, for which the paintings have been done by Dhurandhar. So these are some of the works done for that. In fact, there is one incident which his daughter mentions in her diaries, that wherever they went on different tours. They also went when some patron called them and offered them work. And we have Dhurandhar collecting different kinds of costumes from wherever he traveled. So he was very intrigued, and it was a useful thing for him, apparently. Then, of course, the Pathare Prabhu, his community, was always his favorite subject. And they, as you can see here, they are quite well-dressed and trendy. And this lady is wearing high heel shoes as a contrast to what the other lady is, simple, traditional Nawari. Both are wearing the Nayanar sari, but in different ways. So the women of India, the various communities from various regions captured his attention. Then he has done another interesting illustrated book called The Byways of Bombay, which was written by Edwards. And you have again different sites of Bombay. These are the Siddhis, which were a community originally from South Africa, from Africa, some African tribe, and their descendants had come to Bombay, migrated to Bombay. So these are those. Then there are very interesting things like this Marwari portly gentleman selling batasas, something which you don't even come across these days, and one selling Malpuva jalebi. I must mention here that his mentor, his teacher Griffiths, also did a lot of these kind of drawings. Griffiths and Lockwood Kipling both traveled all over India, and then they produced these works, which are a kind of a reflection of the British taste for capturing India, capturing picturesque India. Then this is that book by Kincaid, where he it's called Deccan Nursery Tales, which Dhurandhar took up. Then he did also postcards. So it's a variety of work. He was quite, versatile. And also he was very productive also. And then here you have the oleographs. On the right, you have an advertisement for Woodward's Gripe Water. And his oleographs were, by the way, printed in the press in Lonavala, owned by Ravi Verma. I'm just going to come back to it. Well, after having had a look at Dhurandhar's career, let's go and see the works of Dhurandhar's daughter. Dhurandhar's daughter, Ambika, studied in JJ School of Art from 1926 to 1931. Is the mic okay? Where her class fellows included Gopal Deuskar, Gondhar Ekar, and also Angela Trindal. As the senior artist recounts in his memoirs, that's Dhurandhar I'm talking about, Ambika's premature exit from the Karve Kanya Shaya in the bustling quarter of Bombay and admission to the art school was forced by circumstances. In 1926, Dhurandhar relocated from Thakur Dwar in the heart of the city to the then quiet suburb of Khar, where he had built with his cautious savings his own house, Ambasadan. It was now convenient for the father and daughter to travel together to the JJ School of Art, his in his teaching capacity and she as a student. Because he would not allow his daughter to take public transport like the tram and all which he's written about. Ambika proved to be a diligent student with fairly accomplished skills of painting. This is the kind of work which she did as a student in the school. And this is the kind of academic work which is in the art school collection in large numbers even today. And it shows the kind of pedagogy which was followed year after year in the British, during the British rule and also thereafter. So she knew how to draw and paint. She could also handle the nude, as one can see here, which was had already been introduced by Solomon. And then of course she did what was called pictorial composition. And here she is, you know, so much like her father. I mean, the way she handles her, you know, even her figure types, her brushwork, her palette, it almost kind of echoes what Dhurandhar did. These are all a part of this JJ School of Art collection. Some of them are quite dramatic. So she also selected subjects which were either given to her in the class or also, and also this was the time when she was a student there, but also from her own, out of her own interest. Some of the works are quite dramatic, and this is not dated. We don't know when she has done this exactly, but both of them, father and in fact the whole family, love theater. And this particular painting reminds me of the theatrical poses. They are so, it's so dramatic in that sense, you know. It's extremely exaggerated and dramatic. And just to bring home the point, I thought I will get a close-up of the figures of Ambika and those of Dhurandhar. Unless you look at the signature, you know, sometimes you can't really make out the difference. So her works from her art school days bear an indelible stamp of her father's style in the figure types, the mannerisms, the sartorial taste, techniques of colouring, and influence which she could never shed off in her lifetime. In fact, both of them even signed similarly. In fact, Ambika was copying, literally copying her father's signature, except for A, the initial A. Hers was AM and his was MV, you know, curled up altogether. So the dramatic content is very obvious in many of her works such as this. More than her paintings, it is her memoirs which are very interesting to read. They are called Majhi Smaran Chitre. They throw a lot of light on the senior Dhurandhar and his artist daughter, whom he fondly referred to as Ambutai. Drafted over a period of time, Ambutai's diaries could be published as late as 2010, a year after she had passed away. The memoirs are a lucid compilation of colonial times and illuminate the career of Rao Bahadur Dhurandhar and his wide social circle of friends, colleagues, patrons and admirers, including Panta Pratinidhi and Bal Gandharva. Ambika in her writings comes across as a dutiful daughter who literally hero worshipped her father, a father who was fiercely protective about her. Incidentally, Ambika never married, you know, and so Angela also never married. So, for different reasons, but that is one of the ways they, you know, there was a lot of, they never moved away from their home. So the bonding with the father perhaps was, with the family was even more. I'm going to talk about, take you back a little bit because I think it's important to make a note of this. Sorry, to this work. One of her entries in the memoirs is significant, wherein she writes about Ravi Verma meeting her father. Curiously, Dhurandhar Sr. does not mention this meeting. When the celebrity artist Ravi Verma paid a visit to the Bombay Art Society, a show which was held there in 1894, he was impressed by an oil painting by Dhurandhar, who was still studying at the art school. Titled Musicians, I'm talking about this, it featured the popular songstress of the times, Anjani Bai Malpekar. Not only did Ravi Verma buy the work, he writes Ambutai, but he also asked the odd Dhurandhar to make 4 copies to be sold to some buyers, to some collectors. Subsequently, the painting was made into an oleograph in Ravi Verma's press at Lonavala, Marauli. Ambiko also remembers the German printer Fritz Schlesser visiting their home to take artworks for printing to the press. She writes that he used to come early morning from Marauli, travel all the way to Khar, take the father's artworks and go back and print them, and also give them some money. Anjani Bai, the singer in Dhurandhar's painting, turned out to be a major inspiration for Ravi Verma later, who painted her quite often. She was the model for various paintings like Lady in the Moonlight, a very well-known work of his. Ambutai also remembers vividly Bal Gandharva's visit to their home and the theatre personality enthusiastically inspecting Maharashtrian shelas, that is the kind of the shawl which is taken by Maharashtrians during the weddings, and nuts, the nut, in the family possession. He was keen that jewellers copy some of these ornament designs for his own performances, his own drama performances. Ambika was elated to win a competition to design a box in connection with the 60th birthday celebrations of Maharaja Sayajirao Gaikwad of Baroda, and they travelled to the princely state with her father to receive the honour. These were happy times when one could afford to have extended stays in the courts of the rulers. Her memoirs record several incidents where she worked alongside her father. Ambika Dhurandhar recalls a visit to the court of Palanpur after the demise of Dhurandhar, where the ruler held an exhibition to which several dignitaries, including Lord Mountbatten, was invited. And in fact, he was quite impressed by her work, so she writes. Till many years after her father's demise in 1944, Ambika continued to conduct art classes by the name of Dhurandhar Kala Mandir at Ambasadan, which she started in 1949. A great admirer of Shivaji, Ambika Dhurandhar's major public exhibition was the one which was held in 1980 on the Raigarh Fort to commemorate the 300th birth anniversary of the Maratha ruler. And it was inaugurated those days by the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. So that is something about Ambika and her father. And now we'll go on to the other father and the daughter, Trindad and Angela. Dhurandhar's accomplished contemporary, A.X. Trindad, worked hard to achieve an enviable position as a painter and a teacher. Having arrived from Goa, Trindad enrolled at J.J. School of Art in 1887, proving his merit by winning several awards and scholarships as a student. Appointed as an assistant teacher in 1898, Trindad rose to occupy significant positions in the art school, finally being appointed as superintendent of the Ray Workshop at J.J. School of Art, a position from where he took voluntary retirement in 1926 because of his ill health. There is a slight ambiguity regarding Trindad's appointment in the workshop. According to Patho Mittar, Trindad was chosen for the coveted post instead of Dhurandhar, as the new principal Cecil Burns viewed Dhurandhar with suspicion, according to him. And the other kind of report of this particular, you know, matter incident is from Don's book, who writes that Trindad was removed from the painting department because he was so good at his work, so efficient. So, I mean, and maybe he posed a threat to Dhurandhar, you know, because they were kind of cordial to each other, but they were not great friends, certainly not. And now Trindad was immensely popular amongst his students in the painting department, and some sources hint that this was a reason why he was given the other post of the superintendent, which gave him little opportunity for mentorship, but which, as Dhone writes in his autobiography, Trindad master, worked to his advantage by transforming a corner of the Ray workshop into a studio where he worked regularly, producing some of his best works there. Records tell us that Trindad in his struggling years supplemented his income by working part-time in the studio of the well-known photographer Raja Deen Dayal, but left the job soon after. Father refused, says his daughter Angela, as he was more interested in teaching at JJ School of Art. Only after school hours and at vacation time did he work at the studio. And she also adds that most of the portraits and other large works done under the name of Raja Deen Dayal were actually what was done by Trindad. Indefatigable in spirit and very prolific, Trindad is remembered mostly for his portraits, though he did paint a few landscapes and other scenes. His large family enthusiastically modeled for him. He did not even have to go out and search for a model. There were so many in the family itself. And he has practically painted all his children. One of his memorable awards remains the one. This is an intimate work of, which tells you about the family sitting in their home in Mahim. Incidentally, both of them, like Dhurandhar, there are so many parallels which I need to pay attention to. Dhurandhar and Trindad's families lived in the heart of the city, and both of them actually, one left for another reason, but Trindad shifted to Mahim, which was a very quiet locality, very peaceful, full of palm trees and the sea, the creek there, because there was a plague in Bombay. And they lived in Dhobi Talao, which was not really a safe area to, it was a congested area even then, and that is why to go out of Bombay, they opted for Mahim, where they built a house. And this is the interior of the house in Mahim. There are 5 of the children have arrived, and that's Florentina, his wife, sitting talking. It's a very intimate special kind of work which he did of his family. Now, this is the work which won him fame. He had already become well known in the art circles of Bombay, but this is a special painting because it was recognized by one of the foremost kind of platforms of art, the Bombay Art Society. The Bombay Art Society, being recognized or winning a medal at the Bombay Art Society was a very important thing for any painter who wanted to make a career, or a sculptor. We also have the instance of Mahatre, the famous sculptor from the Bombay school, who shot to fame when he exhibited that famous work called To the Temple. So you have here his wife, Florentina, who poses for him. She is referred to in this painting as Flora. There are several titles of this painting, but it's also called Flora. And Trindad, by the way, is referred to by many art historians and critics as Rembrandt of the East. And this is actually because he uses a special kind of, way. He has his own special way of rendering light and shade. Focusing on certain parts of the painting and leaving the other in darkness. So somehow I thought this particular work of Rembrandt, the 17th century Baroque painter, was a suitable kind of comparison with Flora's pose here. And Flora, as you can see here, was quite a modern woman. She was also from Goa, and she was religious. The entire family was very religious, but she did not mind posing and showing a little bit of her flesh in this work. This is the portrait of Annie Besant, who was associated with the freedom movement as well as the Theosophical Society. And I don't have works to compare here with his contemporaries, but his use of color, his use of his understanding of light and shade, his bold brush strokes, though they were extremely spontaneous and bold, they still could retain the character, the persona of whoever he was painting. So if you look at a photograph of Annie Besant, you'll immediately know what I mean. So his children were always there for him. This is his daughter Esther, who posed for him, she was around 15, and she also seems to be quite modern in her ways, dressing ways, and this was done at their home. This is a work from the School of Art collection, and I was talking about this, that many of these works where live models were used by the painters, by the artists, are important works in the collection, which give us a clue as to the how the pedagogy developed in the School of Art. So initially they studied from the antique, then they graduated to the drawing in charcoal or pencil, and then finally watercolor, oil color, and so on and so forth. This is in oils, and it is one of the prides of the School of Art collection. And this obsession with showing a woman with a pot kind of continued even later in some of the works like these. And these are some of his masterpieces. So all his portraits, like I just wanted to tell you this, that Florentina was extremely dear, you know, they were a close-knit family. And it was she who had poured in all her savings to build a house, you know, in Mahim. Because Srinath was known for his very indulgent ways. He was very generous with his money. He did not really count his rupees, whatever he got. And if somebody wanted, he would just, you know, part with his money. And then he also was very fond of partying. Whenever there was a celebration, he used to go to the Bombay Art Society all dressed, you know, fashionably, because he wanted to be, you know, seen and liked by people. And he was an extremely loved person, not only in his own community, but also among the art fraternity at that time. And Florentina was also a very warm lady. She used to play the violin very well. They all sang, and she was different because she smoked cheroots those days, which was not a practice in the Christian Catholic community yet so much. Anyways, so coming back to these works, the women sitting posing with the vases. And now his some of his works which he was commissioned to paint. Trindad was not fussy about who the model was. He wanted to, you know, give his best, and that is the you know, that is what he also told his daughter Angela, that you have to give your best. And here you see two totally different kinds of portraits. The one to the left is of Lady Meherbhai Tata, the wife of Sir Dorabji Tata, and somehow this painting did not reach the patron, you know, the one who had commissioned it, for several reasons. One, Lady Meherbhai was not well when this was painted, and subsequently she had to go to Europe to take her treatment for leukemia, I think, and so it stayed with the Trindad family, in the Trindad estate, so it did not go. The other painting, Mrs. Miranda and her little child, is a neighbor. She's a neighbor, and who is to stay close by in Mahim, so he has painted her. So he did not really, you know, he was into his own world. He was painting constantly. He used to love living with his paintings in his home, at his home. And he, apart from the oil works which I'm showing you, we cannot possibly include all his works. He has done a lot of landscapes also. We have one of them. This, apparently, Miss Ferns was also a neighbor from Mahim. And this was their faithful, that one to the right was their faithful family cook who lived in Casabianca. So wonderful portraits, wonderful, you know, capturing of character. And this was what Mahim looked like those days. We are in the 1920s and 30s. So he has done a lot of landscapes of Mahim, which somehow looks like this. Unfortunately, Trindad did not keep too well in the closing years of his life. And the main problem which he had, the illness which he had, was diabetes. And a gangrene had set in one of his legs, which had to be amputated. Even in that state, he was so full of life, so full of vigor, so cheerful, so positive. And he continued to paint even then. And I would love to share this incident which Dhond quotes in his biography, Rappan, which says that once Dhond had gone to see him at his Mahim residence, and he was painting near the creek. You know, he was sitting on the rocks and he was doing a work, landscape. And he kind of just stepped back to look at what he had done, and he did not realize that he had just one leg and he fell down. And he quickly, you know, kind of came back, got back to his feet and continued to work. So that is how he was. And unfortunately, things never really turned better for him, though he was quite a success financially. He also had to be amputated for the other leg, you know. So he was, even in that state, he was extremely jolly. And this particular work, Ekke Homo, was painted around a fortnight before Trindade passed away on the 16th of March, 1935. So we'll come back to this. This is the museum which has been built, which is an old heritage structure where the present collection of Trindade is housed in Goa. It's in Panji, and it's wonderful that so many of his works, because works of both these painters are dispersed in various collections, private as well as public collections and museums. But we are lucky to have his work back in the country. Now coming to Angela, this is the last quarter of our discussion. Trindade's eldest son, Zeferino, wanted to study art. He was, however, discouraged by his father and was asked to take a more lucrative profession. So he did not really encourage his students, his children to do what he did. Despite her father's initial disapproval and dissuasion, Angela enrolled at JJ School of Art in 1927 and proved to be a bright student, learning. So that's a portrait of I just told you that he did a lot of portraits of his family members, and that's Angela as a child. And that's Angela as a grown-up with her sister Esther, whose portrait we saw previously. This is what she did in the art school. She proved to be a bright student, learning European academic drawing admirably and graduating from the school in 1932. Her father's work had a deep influence on Angela during her youth, and Trindade too, once adjusted to the idea of his daughter's career, gave Angela extra training, saying, "One must be true to oneself while creating a picture on the canvas." Angela, these are some of her works. Angela later completed a course in mural decoration from JJ. The year 1936 saw her being awarded the first prize in the All India Women Artists Exhibition. So we have women artists around the 30s, you know. It was an exclusive women artists exhibition. So she also went through the entire kind of, art pedagogy, which was a part of the curriculum there. She also was enrolled in the revivalist class, and she came out with works like this. She studied this particular kind of way of, painting under Ahivasi, who was in charge of the Indian revivalist class. This is the portrait which she has painted of her father. It's quite, actually, though she took inspiration from him, it's obvious that her way of working was quite different from his. She's also done a portrait of Mahatma Gandhi from a photograph, which also gained her a lot of acclaim. Esther recalls, that's her sister, how she and her sister Anja, that is Angela, and Anu, Anelia, were close to their father. The family was fond of music, reading and entertaining, birthdays, Christmas and New Year being big affairs. Angela remained unmarried all her life. Cassia Pinka was an open house, and the children and grandchildren have fond memories of Trindad's tremendous sense of humor, his loving nature, compassion, and generosity. So we were talking about the fact that Angela was influenced by her father very much, and here they also share a model. The portrait to the left is of is the one which is done by Angela, and the one which I'm showing to the right is what we've already seen, and it's quite similar. I mean, in some cases there is a similarity also. This is the kind of work which she did, portraits. And then, inspired by the revivalist style, which she had, the influence which had happened in the school of art, she took to another totally different style of painting for her Christian subjects. Angela had a deep desire to interpret Christian themes in an indigenous style. Though she was well acquainted with the European art traditions of Renaissance and Baroque painting, as also the painting of 19th century Europe. In the 1940s, these works are from that period, Angela Trindad became a part of a community of painters who worked towards the indigenization of the Christ story and, in Angela's own words, endeavored to promote and develop the best that can be found in the life and culture of the country. Along with Angelo da Fonseca, Cardinal Valerian Gracias, and other artists like Frank Wesley, she dedicated a large part of her career to analyzing the problems surrounding Christian art at that time. In 1947, after her first one-person exhibition in Bombay, she devoted her energies from her studies of Indian literature, using them in her paintings as well as murals in church interiors. The biblical subjects now had, as you can see, Indian settings. With the characters in Indian costumes and the palette extremely subdued. Angela, around this time, started traveling frequently, initially to England and later to America, where she stayed with her sister Esther. Esther had married a white man, and she had, gone to the West. She delivered lectures on art at women's forums, schools, and universities. Everywhere that she went, Angela commanded respect as Angela Trindad, Indian artist, and she loved to be referred to in such a manner. The artist also held several exhibitions in Washington, Philadelphia, Cleveland, Toledo, and other places. From the 1950s, now we are into the 50s, Angela veered towards Cubism. A large work of hers hangs in Lisbon in the Mall of Justice. It was commissioned by the government of Portugal, committed to her cause. Angela passed away in 1980 in Brazil while she was visiting her sister there. Ambasadan was pulled down to accommodate a high rise in the last years of Ambutai's life. She had continued to run Dhurandhar Kala Mandir till about 1980. Informs Dr. Nalini Bhagwat, art historian and one of her close associates. Though Ambika had a vast body of her father's works and also antiques collected by him, this suite of works was soon dispersed, bought by collectors in Delhi and Mumbai. As Dhurandhar was very productive and popular, many of Dhurandhar's paintings are in the possession of private collectors who were his enthusiastic and faithful patrons, like Panta Pratinidhi and Seth Purushottam Mauji. Also, they are housed in permanent collections in Kolhapur Museum, Aum Museum, Sangli Museum, Central Museum, Nagpur, and many other places. Ambika's demise in 2009 went almost unnoticed, bringing the curtain down on a legacy. Tragically, Trindad lost all his three sons when they were fairly young. His grandchildren and daughters-in-law, as his daughters, were the inheritors of his paintings. Trindad, like Dhurandhar, was also extremely prolific, as we've already seen, and produced an astounding body of work, which he actually enjoyed living with. Thanks to the initiatives of some members of the large Trindad family, spread out in various corners of the world, Trindad was more fortunate in getting his works retrieved and housed under one roof. Rithindad collection, which includes paintings by the senior Rithindad and his daughter Angela, were donated by Esther Rithindad Trust to Fundação Oriente in Goa in 2004, where they are on permanent display in a warm, approachable museum space, a reflection of the artist's own personality. Thank you. Questions or any queries, we can go ahead with them. Yes? The same one. And apparently those days, as Durandar tells us, because a lot of information and primary source of information is that book, that diary, his salary was raised from 50 rupees to 150 rupees. So that was, in those days, to run a large family, which the Trindads were, it must have meant a lot, you know. Yes, actually.
Sorry, I have two more questions. The second one is about his connection with Bala Sahib Panipat, because at Aung was.
Yes.
Which was supporting that number of artists.
True.
One of them.
Yeah.
So how did that relation, because the patronage changed from 1970. So how was that relation working? And the problem was, you mentioned about the connection between, means the political. Which comes out of his biography.
Yeah.
Specifically talks about, my reading of it, that he also went out a lot.
Yes.
What was happening in school.
Yes.
So how did that politics and the art kind of work
together? Well, first thing first, Abala Rahman was there when Durandar was studying. And in fact, he was a little senior to Durandar. And he was, in a way, an inspiration, a kind of a role model for Durandar, because they both belonged to Kolhapur. And but unfortunately, Abalal Rahman did not remain in JJ, and did not remain in Bombay. Circumstances forced him to go back to Kolhapur, and then he kind of pursued a career of a very successful not in terms of money, but a very flourishing, very bright career in Kolhapur. So that one thing, he knew that Abalal had come to Bombay, come to JJ, he's done meritorious work, he was aware of that. So in that way, he is inspired. What was the other question? Yes. Yes. The thing was that Durandar was invited by Bala Sahib Pant Pratinidhi to Aun to train his daughter, Akka Sahib, who wanted to be a painter. But as Ambutai, again we have to refer to her, she writes that both father, daughter, and also his wife, they all went to and stayed with Durandar, with the family there. Durandar used to train the princes regularly. But she did not really pursue a career after that. But what happened was, Pant Pratinidhi loved Durandar's work. So simultaneously, Durandar was producing a lot of work, not only when they went there, but even earlier for Pant Pratinidhi, who himself was an artist. So any of you have seen the Aung Museum, there are works by Durandar, plenty, and also the works of the patron, the ruler. And then he was also, Durandar was also asked to take up the subject of Shivaji, which he has painted very frequently for Pant Pratinidhi. So, and they were very close, they were certainly very close. I mean, he was extremely, he had that political correct kind of a position, but that was always there in his career. That is maybe one of the reasons why they were so close, and why Solomon dared to call him Titian of India. You're going to be the next Titian of India. But there were also some murmurs, like he was not really very popular. He was respected, all right. He had his close coterie of friends, but there were also some people who did not really like his attitude, you know, to say yes, yes, yes all the time to the, you know, bend down to the colonial kind of, you know, pressures, which were always happening in the school of art. Yes.
So in the last one was about his biography, where he talks about his school of art in the
book, yes.
In the book, and with specific references to, he was being unhappy that what was happening in South Kent isn't getting implemented directly.
Yes, because some were not suit, some he was not comfortable with, and he could not help it, you know. Things had to move. He had also had enemies within the colleagues, many of them. Then when there was a Pathare Prabhu exhibition, even his own community people kind of opposed him. So he had his friends, foes, allies. But Ambutai throughout his life never raised a voice against her father. So she was always with him, you know, in spirit and even, you know, physically present to look after him.
My question is more basic. Both artists are not definitely, but Trinidad underexplored in that sense, underpromoted. The reason why he didn't reach a higher fame, I mean, as an artist, he seems to be already on the West India.
He was, certainly. Well, the latter part of my this thing answered, because I have showed an image of that museum. His paintings were not available easily, because most of them, he also had some wealthy patrons whose works he painted, but because the family dispersed, you know, his daughters got married and they went away. Angela was in America for a long time, and then as I told you, he lost all his sons. So There was no mooring in Mahima later on, and then somehow they wanted to get back his work, and they worked in collaboration with the Portuguese government, and that is how, because he was, in fact, he there is a mention that he was actually a Hindu, and three generations back they had converted to Christianity, you know, which was happening very frequently in Goa, in a place like Goa. So yes, but because he was a Catholic, the Portuguese government rendered full support to the family to get back a large. I mean, you must visit the museum if you have not done it already. It's a beautiful. It's got about 20 odd works of Prindan. Because as you said, they are not accessible. There's one or two, perhaps in the own museum, one or two here and there. And some in the National NGMA, but you can't see too many. So my whole endeavor was to get a large number of Trindad's work here. And for that matter, you don't see many of the daughters also. No, they weren't. But there are mentions in Durandar's autobiography that Ambika helped him with the murals which they did for the Delhi Secretariat. She used to design the ornamental designs, or she used to be a helper kind of a thing in a secondary role. She never overshadowed of her father. Maybe she was not good enough, or she was, you know, she was not different. So she was like very, you know, comfortable being in his shadows all the time. Yes. Durandar certainly, and no, unlike what happened in Bengal, these painters were like, even their generation of painters like Pithawala and Pestanji Bumanji, though they painted a lot of their own social, you know, milieu and the social circle, they were not involved in any way with the nationalists, in the larger, way in the nationalist movement. Or none of them really, this kind of, concerns or engagement does not reflect in their works, of the Bombay painters largely.
And that seems to be the problem with the, the partisan data, major attention from Hossain, Souza, all of them.
Yes.
They never seem to sort of reflect a very important issue in the Indian social political
survey. Yes, but nothing to do with the nationalist agenda.
Isn't that one of the reasons I think art fundamentally has not become that relevant to many people? Because it's not really mirroring important social issues, but it's trying to sort of still stay on the realms of, I'm not saying decorative, but very soft subjects.
Because that was a tradition which was imbibed in the School of Art. Precisely that is what I'm trying to say, that the Bombay School was all about European, the pattern of education and the entire training was, that gave them that vision that it was closed in a way, though it was extremely, superior in many ways, it was a closed kind of a vision which they got from there.
This was specifically the Delhi School of Art?
Yes. So I thought because all of them belonged to that art school and they emerged from the art school and they were also, parents and the daughters, I would take this up for the presentation. Thank you.